Welcome to Digital Nation, your weekly journey around the best of local TV. Whether it's a vegetarian black pudding recipe or a milk vending machine, we reveal the things you don't normally see anywhere else. This week, we meet Jessica from Brighton, teaching us British Sign Language. We go to the ballet and meet the director of the Russian State Ballet of Siberia. We go high up a steeple and artistically over a bridge. Are you living local? Then let us know what you think by using the hashtag DigitalNation. First up, what happens when the technical director of the Russian State Ballet of Siberia visits Cardiff? Magic happens, that's what. In our first clip, Made in Cardiff gives us a behind-the-scenes tour of the ballet. And we hear from the man himself as we check out the dancers practicing their elegant steps.
As you can see, I've now come backstage here at St. David's Hall to talk to Vitaly, who is the technical director. Vitaly, lovely to see you. The run is halfway through now. How's it all going?
I can say it's going very well. I can hear the audience likes the performance. I can hear great applause and very warm welcome from the audience.
Now, you started this season here at St. David's Hall with Snow Maiden, and it was the premiere of that ballet outside of Russia. What was that like, bringing that here to Cardiff?
We are very proud to bring this kind of ballet in Cardiff and in UK especially, because we think this is typically Russian ballet, and only Russians can perform this ballet. With these souls, with our souls, with our attitude to this creation.
Now, obviously, it must have been fantastic for the audience to see something that they'd never seen before. Was it very special, the performance?
Yes. All dancers, they are very keen of bringing this dance to the audience, and they trained and they prepared a lot of time. Actually, we come here, I think it's a 10th time.
Wow, gosh.
In the city. So we know many, many places here. Of course, it's we wait for this. We wait for this moment quite a long time before.
A traditional and nutritious food has been given a makeover, including new vegetarian and gluten-free recipes. Now enjoying a fashionable moment in the superfood spotlight, That's Lancashire Reports on a British favourite that's definitely here to stay. Black pudding, take it away.
Andrew Holt has won many awards and he's actually a knight of the black pudding.
We've always extolled the virtues of black puddings and we've always known that they've been a superfood, especially good for expectant mothers, people with anemia, the elderly. It's a really good product. As well as our traditional black puddings, which we make a lot of, we also produce a gluten-free variety. And we also do a vegetarian version, which a lot of people say is a bit of an oxymoron, but it's just as good. It's got the same ingredients apart from the obvious two, which is blood and fat. So we substituted the blood with beetroot, which has the same qualities as blood. It's got lots of iron and antioxidants in it. And we've replaced the fat with vegetable suet, which is a non-hydrogenated fat, which is also good for you.
If there's one person to give us a cookery lesson, he's the man.
So then we're going to fry our apples off. Now, I've used not cooking apples. These are good quality eating apples. You can use Braeburn, Cox's, Pink Lady. Then you need to put your black pudding in. This is a chilli one. Now, what you've got to remember about black pudding, it's already cooked. So basically, you're colouring it and warming it. The apples first. Just to finish it off, a little bit of nutmeg. And it's on.
Jessica Kellgren-Hayes is one of Brighton's star presenters. And in this next clip, she teaches us some keywords in British Sign Language. From useful weather words to the colours of the rainbow. Now you'll not only learn the signs, but also get a glimpse as to how these signs originate from the on-screen graphics. In this next clip from Belfast, we're invited into the personal worlds of other people's experiences from around Europe, as testimonies from survivors are shared across cities via artistic sound installations. People listen to these emotional stories as they walk symbolically over a bridge, passing through the storms.
My feet clack on the path. I want to run, but I walk steadily forward. Just keep walking.
Nedelja posle podne.
The idea for Bridging the Silence came whenever we were at Three Artists were put together as part of the Corners project. We had to find some common ground, and what we found that really interested us was the fact of communication and silence and giving people a voice and what's not said.
I stop at the fear and face it. The smell comes back first. The smoke on his breath, sweat, then the hands cold on my skin.
What I found important in this project is that it's not important from where you are come and what is your background. You can suffer really a lot. So our main goal with this project was to bring different stories from different sides, because it's about humanity and about how people can pass through completely same situation, but they are divided because of some kind of politicians, religion, language, whatever. And in the end, this is not important. The life is important.
Very much puts you in the first person of the experience, so you come away at the end of it having really thought through how that person feels. So I thought it was awesome for what it's trying to achieve.
500 years ago, a pilgrim walked 200 miles from Southampton to Canterbury. Now this walk along Pilgrim's Way has been reenacted step by step by former teacher Stephen Payne, whose arduous journey included sleeping in graveyards and washing in sheep troughs.
Stephen Payne headed to Canterbury on the 14th of December, following in the footsteps of an Italian teacher, Carluccio de Carrera. He set off walking northwards to the shrine of St. Swithin of Winchester, then eastwards, arriving in Canterbury for the feast of Thomas Becket on the 29th of December. 188 miles in total, without using sat-nav or even a map.
They wouldn't have used maps back in the 14th century, or the maps that they had back in the 14th century wouldn't have been much use. I was basically following the Pilgrim's Way waymarkers, and along the North Downs Way, of course, you've got the chalk path that goes eastward. If I got lost, I just headed towards the rising sun. And there were a couple of times when I got lost. I actually walked for 2 or 3 hours in the wrong direction at one point. But of course, you meet people along the way and you can always stop them and ask them, am I on the road to Canterbury? As an amateur historian, I wanted to do something that was authentic as possible. So I spent 6 months researching everything from the clothing to the kit that I carried. The clothing was largely modelled on the clothing from a chap called the Boxton Man, who was a 14th century traveller who was bopped over the head and dumped in a peat bog back in the mid-1360s. The major part of the clothing is the kirtle, which is like a long dress that falls just below the knee. Over the top of that would go a medieval cloak, which is basically my survival blanket, my tent and my bedroll all rolled into one. And on top of that would be a hood. The cloak weighs roughly 2 stone. It's made of a very heavy felted wool, which is waterproof because the lanolin's been left in it, and wool is naturally waterproof. It's enormously heavy, but during the evening it was really a lifesaver when it came to comfort, warmth and obviously keeping the rain off.
One of Stephen's concerns was if the weather was severe, that he might need to camp down in a church porch or graveyard. He wrote to the clergy and received blessings and support from the Pope, the Bishop of Portsmouth and the Canon of Canterbury Cathedral.
I wasn't allowed to stop anywhere that wasn't in existence when the original pilgrimage took place, nor was I allowed to buy food anywhere unless that was there when the original pilgrimage took place. So I was only able to buy food in a pre-14th century establishment. So in most cases, I was sleeping rough in the trees and the bushes along the way.
Stephen reached Canterbury at midday on the 29th, 15 days after setting off from Southampton. His clothing stood up extraordinarily well to the rigours, but one can't help but wonder, how did he keep clean?
I basically washed my undergarments. There's a pair of shorts called brays. So I wore one and I washed one, usually in a stream or a cattle trough of some sort. So I was actually sat in a sheep trough one day having a wash when a chap walking his dog came along. So I had to do a bit of explaining there, but it was very doable.
That brings us to the end of part one. So it can only be quiz time. Which city was known by the nickname of Lininopolis in the 19th century due to its linen trade? Was it A, Derby, B, Swansea, or C, Belfast? Join us in part two to find out the answer. Welcome back to Digital Nation. Before the break, we asked you, which city was known by the nickname of Lininopolis in the 19th century due to its linen trade? And the answer is C, Belfast. With the Civil War in the US disrupting the supply of American cotton to Europe, Belfast soon became the largest producer of linen in the world. If you've been inspired to get walking, then this next clip should provide some useful tips in how to do it in record-breaking time. Leeds is the UK centre for race walking, and Tom Bozzy Bosworth holds three British records and is the current UK champion. Here he is, putting Beth Krista Wilson through her paces.
Right, well, what is the first step to becoming a race walker? How do I even start?
Right, so first of all, I'm going to put you on a line.
Okay.
And all I'm going to get you to do is just walk up and down and imagine you're on a tightrope.
Okay.
So one foot in front of the other.
Do you lock up or...?
I would say look forward, yes. Okay. Otherwise you'll just end up hitting the ground.
Thanks for that.
Okay, right.
How's that so far?
That stop. So that's a pretty basic walking movement, yes?
Yeah.
Yeah, so obviously you want to go a little bit quicker than that, but staying within the rules. So you would have what most race walkers have, pretty normal running arms,
yep,
or kind of a little bit lower and a nice drive. We're going to try and walk with our feet across the line. That's really going to encourage, because with race walking you have a tiny little bit more hip movement.
Yeah.
And with that little bit more hip movement you can get a bigger stride as well. So all you're going to do is overlap. That's it.
This feels really weird.
Does it feel weird?
It feels really weird. Am I stride small or is that okay?
No, that's a really good stride. Make sure you're landing on the heel still. You go a bit faster? Keep up with me? Yeah, obviously trying to pull up your toes, and if you've got tight calves as well, that's always going to really have to work hard. And internationally, you go up to 50 kilometres. So when you start to tire, you can imagine that people start landing with a bent leg.
Yeah, just because of the strain on the...
Yeah.
How long would it take for you to do 20 kilometres?
My personal best is 1 hour 22 minutes. That's about a 1 hour 26 half marathon. So that kind of puts
it
into perspective.
Incredible. Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm pretty impressed. You seem fairly pleased with what I did.
Yeah, really good.
But now I want to see you do it properly, because it's just not going to compare watching me do it. So if you'd give us a little demo of how the pros do it, that'd be great.
Yeah, no problem.
Adopting and fostering children is a caring endeavour. And for Jackie and Alan Bennett, it's been a lifelong mission to give local children a loving and supportive environment to live in. And now, after 40 years, the couple have been awarded an MBE for their services. Big Centre TV reports.
We've been fostering for 40 years and we've had 179 placements. But everyone's special.
The couple have been together from the age of 14 and hit their early 20s when they first began to foster.
Something inside that said it was the right thing to do, and we've done it, and we've just continued over the years. We've had our ups and downs. You have children that need extra care and extra attention, but they give you such good response back, you get so much pleasure out of it. It takes the children out of the situations they can be in, and then with the help and support of agencies, they can go back then to their families. Then the families may need support, and then social services can give it to them. And these children then get a better quality of life.
Over the past 40 years, Alan and Jackie have not only fostered 179 children, but went on to adopt 10 of them. 19-year-old Chloe was 20 months old when she was adopted by the couple. Even though 21 is the minimum age to become a foster parent, it's definitely something Chloe has on her mind.
Why would you want to take up fostering in the future?
To help other children out, to let them have a better life than they already had in the past. So.
And why do you think that's important?
So they get the life that they deserve.
Alan and Jackie are one of the two couples in Wolverhampton awarded with MBEs in the Queen's New Year's Honours List.
I think it's absolutely fantastic they've been recognised in this way. They've worked with us for so many years and they've looked after so many children.
It's an experience, it's not for the faint-hearted, but it's just been one of those things that you've took in your stride.
And I think a lot more people should be doing it.
When is a train both a tram and a train? When it's a tram train, of course. Moving seamlessly over tram and rail tracks, this new scheme in Sheffield is set to revolutionise travel in the city and beyond. So let's check out the new pilot vehicles keeping Sheffield's public transport system on track to be one of the most innovative in Britain.
3, 2, 1...
When the doors opened and we saw this magnificent vehicle emerge from the depot, I think the frisson of excitement went around the entire place. The immediate impact, of course, will be improving the public transport between Sheffield and Rotherham. So that will benefit the two populations and also South Yorkshire more broadly. But actually, there's a further benefit as well. This is something we've never done before in the UK. This is a tram train. It's something, a vehicle which can go from the light rail system, a tram system, onto the heavy rail system. And we've never been in that place before, and that presents all sorts of opportunities for us. So that's why it's called a pilot. That's why everybody is really looking to see what will happen. This landmark event is the formal welcoming of this vehicle into Sheffield, and we now need to get it through its trials, get it onto the tram network, see how that operates, learn everything we can about it, and expand it from there. And that's quite an exciting thought.
Do you think this could be done in other cities across the UK as well?
I think they'll be looking at what happens here with much interest and thinking, okay, wonder if I can make this work for my area too. But that, who doesn't think that? You know, this is a new idea. This is an exciting time for public transport.
Over to Nottinghamshire now, and a look at a novel way to sell the old cold white stuff. Innovative milk vending machines are a way for farmers to cut out middle suppliers and address the problem of low milk prices. A struggle now facing farmers all over the world.
Pick up a pint of milk at a supermarket and it'll likely have travelled miles long before it makes it into your cuppa or onto your cornflakes. On this Notts farm, though, just a few hundred yards from the cowshed, there's a shed of an altogether different kind. Inside, they've installed a vending machine, not stocked with crisps or chocolate bars, but with the farm's very own milk.
The idea behind the vending machine was basically to try and add value to the product that we're producing already. It was a novel way of doing something different, as it's the only one in Nottinghamshire. The milk prices over the last few years have been very volatile. They've been up, they've been down. Just in the last couple of years, they've just stayed down and hit rock bottom. It's a massive struggle to carry on, so you have to try and find ways of adding value to what you're doing.
Dairy farmers around the country have struggled with the price for their product for some time as global milk prices hit an all-time low. If a farm like this one sells to a supplier, they can get anything between 16 and 23 pence a litre. When you consider they can sell it themselves for a pound a litre, you can see why they'd want to cut out the middleman. And that's exactly what the vending machine does. The farmers estimate that they're currently selling about 50 litres a day from the vending machine. With almost 400 cows on the farm, each producing around 4,000 litres a year, it's not the sole means of selling their milk. It could, though, be a sign of the dairy industry moving in a new direction.
Finally, a rare treat as we enter Glasgow's Tolbooth steeple to discover the history behind the stone and ironwork of one of the city's most iconic buildings. In its past, this ancient tower has imprisoned criminals and thieves and has inspired local stories of black magic, witches and warlocks.
A toll booth was like a one-stop civic shop. It's where you had the council chambers and also where you had the court and also had the prison. This is where the citizens of Glasgow used to come along to pay their taxes or their tolls, hence toll booth. It's one of the most famous buildings in the city and its exteriors are well known from postcards and photographs the world over. But very few people get to see the interiors. But we're going in there today. It's 38 and a half metres high, or 126 feet in old money. The steeple, in fact, is a giant staircase which allowed access to the main toll booth building, which was through here. In fact, you can still see the doors on each level that allowed you to go through. And fantastically, this is one of the original pieces of ironwork that the prisoners used to look through as they stared out from their cells. But it wasn't just thieves and other day-to-day miscreants. On more than one occasion, men and women accused of being witches and warlocks were held here. Not a great situation to be in, as until 1735, the punishment for black magic was execution. The other main use for the steeple was the clock, which had four faces so that it could be seen by everybody in the town. It also had an exotic set of bells and chimes, and they had a professional musician who used to come along at 1 o'clock every day and play a concert for all the Glaswegians as they were having their lunch in the town. He actually used a very special device to do this, and apparently it's still here today. And you know, I never knew this was up here. This is one of the most fantastic pieces of ancient Glasgow that we've got. There's 16 of these paddles, and each one of them is connected by one of these wires to a bell up on the roof. And you push it really hard, and it rings, as simple as that. And I'm sure I've got fire engines running towards me right now. Yes! I bet that.
And that completes our bevy of besties. If our stories have piqued your interest, then don't forget, you can always nip over to bbc.co.uk/digitalnation to watch recent episodes. So until next week, goodbye.